September back to our routines, and although it does seem like, you know, summer should still be continuing for a while, I'm awfully glad to have us all together. And we're really fortunate to have State Representative Lenny Mira with us this morning, just to, you know, to give us an update on things that he's working on, or to, you know, answer a few questions. And Lenny's been a very good friend all along. It's really been lovely to, you know, have this nice working relationship together.
Love it.
But next month, October, Chris Comiskey from the Historical Society will be with us, and will actually give a presentation on her. She does a graveyard, you know, tour around Halloween, so she'll give us sort of the, what do I want to say, the armchair version.
Is that apropos for an elderly group?
I know, we'll have to, maybe I shouldn't serve high-test coffee.
Why, you know, some old folks?
Well,
I know.
But, so Chris will be here then, and in November, Karen Tyler will be with us for, because it's going to be Veterans Month, so Karen is our Director of Veteran Services for our area, and she will be with us for the November men's breakfast. So we've just been planning away here. Got ourselves scheduled right through the end of December.
All right.
So I'm going to turn it right to you. We'll do a little bit more cleanup, but thank you very much.
Absolutely. No, I love doing it. I always look forward to it. You know, every sitting town has a Council on Aging, some more active than others, and yours is very active.
That's
what we like to see. It's why we have this.
Yeah.
And exactly. We were just talking about this new facility here. This is my first time doing this breakfast here. We always did it before.
That's right. Yeah.
It's my first time here. And I was just telling Colleen that every sitting town, you know, is faced with having to build new buildings. Everything from a school to a police station to a senior center.
Right.
Groveland is looking to do one right now. Newburyport built a nice one. They spent over $7 million. Mm-hmm. And we did this for less than one half of $1 million. Smart. And we used our facilities. We already owned it.
Yeah.
And it was a very wise thing.
Well, and we had that lovely partnership with Whittier, which helped bring down some of our costs in the facilities department.
Oh, the students at Whittier did a lot of work.
Yes, they did a lot.
Saves
a lot of money.
And the students learned how to do their jobs.
Yeah.
And now they're graduating or moving on with the skills.
And our facilities guys are very, very helpful.
Yes, yes. Mr. Durkee does a wonderful job.
Mike Anderson.
Yeah. Oh, for
yes.
Okay, but thank you, Colleen. Yeah.
Oh, no, thank you.
My name is Lenny Mira. I'm the state rep for the 2nd Essex District, and my district is Newbury, West Newbury, Georgetown, Groveland, Boxford, Merrimack, and a little bit of Haverhill. And one of the best things we do, from the funnest things we do, is we get to meet people up close and personal like this, and we look forward to it because we like to bring people up to date on what's going on and who can help. It's a very slow time right now. They pretty much shut down in August. There's not a lot going on. The place is empty. We will probably start back with formal sessions next week. And there's a lot of things on the agenda. The speaker said it's going to be a very, very busy year, which is good because we've got a lot of issues on our plate. And you know, top of the list will be things like, you know, healthcare. It's a huge issue right now. That comprises most of the spending on Beacon Hill. We have a budget of over $40 billion a year, and most of it will go just to healthcare, So the effects of that are everything else tends to get squeezed. Roads, bridges, schools, colleges, seniors, veterans, everything else we want to invest in will get squeezed because more and more of our money goes to healthcare. So that's something we've got to tackle. Massachusetts has some of the highest healthcare costs in the country and probably the world. So we're addressing that now. Unfortunately, we have a governor that worked in that industry before becoming governor, and he's going to make his pitch to try to reform the marketplace, which I think is what has to happen. The other thing that we're working on right now are crises, I call it a crisis, opioids. We have a really bad issue with opioids in the state and the country. What we're discovering is that marijuana is not really the gateway drugs to heroin. It's actually prescription medications. A lot of people get addicted to prescription medications, painkillers, and when the prescription expires, there's an addiction there. And heroin is a cheap way to fill that need for that addiction. So we're using science and reason trying to figure that out and what we're going to do about it. So we'll be working on that as well. And then the other things are the typical infrastructure, housing, colleges and universities. Massachusetts, fortunately, has a very good school system. I think it's probably the best public educational system in the country today. And if you look at our test scores, if Massachusetts was a country, our test scores would rank right up there among the best countries in the world. And we do a very good job at it. This place was a good example. Pro School is one of the best schools in the state. our students perform above average on our test scores, and we spend below average per student. And it's a testament to the people in that room, from Superintendent Carol Jacobs to everyone else, right down to the teachers who are making sure that Massachusetts has a good K-12 educational system. It's vital. It's the reason why Massachusetts has a vibrant economy today. We don't have a lot of natural resources. Like a lot of states, we don't have oil or gas. We don't have a lot of agriculture. Our natural resource is our brain power. We have colleges and universities here that are able to take our students, turn them into working professionals, and that's given us a huge advantage. So, of course, it's something we want to continue. Massachusetts, like I said, is limited in other natural resources. We don't have a lot of space. We're a very expensive state to operate in. Before becoming a state rep, I ran a construction company right up the street here in Georgetown. Very difficult place to do business in. A lot of regulations, a lot of restrictions, a lot of taxes, and you know, a lot of smaller businesses are moving out of state because of that. And especially my district borders New Hampshire. That's a real issue. I don't want to see people and businesses moving from Massachusetts into New Hampshire, but we're seeing a lot of that because of our regulatory environment and because of our tax implications. So all these things will be worked on, and I look forward to jumping into it next week. But what I'd like to do is really open it up to hear anyone has personal questions or issues or something you'd like to know or just a comment. Gary usually has something.
Nothing right now.
Nothing today?
There was something
okay.
In my head. I lost it, but I'll get back to you.
You'll get back to me on it. That's okay.
I think I know the answer. But is there any way that we as citizens can ask for a repeal of the raises the leadership took for themselves?
Yeah, I'd love to do that. And they did it in a very specific way. The raises that were given to the legislature was in a bill tied to the raises we also gave our judges. Now, the judges in the Commonwealth went a long time without a raise, and they probably deserved one. It's a full-time job, and you need people with law degrees in it. And so they were, in my opinion, deserving of a raise. And so we tied our raises to it so that, because under Massachusetts law now, we cannot repeal them like we could if it was just a raise for the legislature. And it was kind of a sneaky thing to do. And that was one of the main reasons why I voted against it. I voted against the pay increase, and when the governor vetoed it, I voted to support his veto. And we came close to supporting it, Doug. We needed 54 votes to support his veto, and we only got 44. It was that close. So the pay raise went forward, and it was totally unfair. There were no hearings. There was no press about it up front. There was no real discussion about it. And the raises were massive. People in leadership got $15,000, $30,000 raises, which is outrageous. Right. Outrageous, just completely uncalled for. And by the way, back in the 90s, we passed a bill that tied legislative raises to family household income in Massachusetts, which I think is fair. We should tie it to that. And so in the beginning of the year, household income went up 2.5%. And so we had a 2.5% increase, which is fine. But then on top of that, the Democrat leadership decided, no, we're going to have another increase on top of that. They couldn't raise salaries. What they raised was stipends, travel and office expenses, stipends, and leadership pay. And so on top of that 2.5%, you know, we got 10, 20, 30% raises, which, like I said, is totally outrageous. You know, people ask, well, what are you going to do with your raise? And at first I said, I was just going to deny it. I didn't even take it. Because I thought the money would go into the general funds. That's not how it works. If a state rep chooses not to take his raise, it goes into the special house fund, which the Speaker of the House controls, Robert DeLeo. And of course, we know how he's going to spend it.
Oh, he got one of the big raises.
The money would go into a fund that he can use to pay for meals and travel for his people. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to donate my raise to charitable causes in the district and organizations around here. Because it just wasn't fair in an environment where, yeah, the economy's good, there's a lot of jobs, but wages are not increasing. They're just not going up the way they should. They're very small incremental raises, and only in certain industries. If you're in high tech or healthcare, you're probably getting a good raise. But if you're in construction, if you're in a blue collar job, you're not getting those big raises. You're just not. And so, to answer your question, Doug, it's a difficult thing. I think they're going to try to put on a ballot question.
Would it have to be like a citizen's petition?
It may have to be, but it's questionable because our raises were tied to the judges' increases. And by constitutional law, I guess we cannot repeal that on a ballot question. So it's going to be tricky to answer that question. But it was a truly underhanded way to do it. It never should have happened, and it created a lot of ill will among people. And you'll notice it was done at the very outset of our session. It was the very first thing that the speaker put out when we, you know, got reelected. And they did that, obviously, so that voters would forget about it come 2018, which I just think is very underhanded. It never should have happened. I voted against it, and if a petition comes along to repeal our raises, yeah, I'll absolutely support it. But it's a good question. Thanks. Sure.
I came up with mine now, and it was when you were talking about education.
Yes.
And just to echo, yes, as much as many of us think Georgetown spends way too much for the cost of educating, what you said was right. We're under the average, and our students do place well, and they do need a hand of credit for that. But what came to my mind at the time was the high cost of college.
Yes.
And if you're doing anything there, and I feel that a lot of it is tied into the fact of elected officials, when they don't get reelected or when they decide to retire, go to a college.
Yep.
And at a very high salary, and that, I believe, probably goes towards continuing their pension and raising the cost of their pension and benefits. And is there anything we can do for that sort of thing? I'll leave names out. I mean, like, I know a rep that recently wasn't reelected, I believe went to a college until the rep then finally got reelected to another state position, and just, you know, well, we'll put you over here, we'll give you this college, you'll continue with your benefits and building your pension. And
unfortunately, you're exactly right. I hate to admit it, but it's true.
Yeah.
If you look at the state's payroll and where all the big salaries are, I think UMass probably tops the list as the agency with the most people making six-figure salaries. And when you look at the big picture, you'll notice that if you trace their spending, it's not going into the students or facilities or even into faculty. No, it's going to what they call administration. It's going to the overhead of a college. That has exploded in recent years.
Mm-hmm.
I went to Boston College 30 years ago, a long time ago, and the ratio of faculty to administration was a lot more even. Now, faculty has not grown very much. In fact, a lot of them are not even tenured anymore. They're part-time professors. But administration, which is what you're talking about, Doug, has exploded, especially at places like UMass. Now, we've got to look at the original mission of UMass. Every state created colleges, universities, so that students had a place to go to that they could afford, that a middle-class family could afford, because most people cannot afford a Boston College or a Harvard or an MIT. And now UMass is starting to become more expensive every single year, in large part, I believe, what you just talked about. We just put too many people on administration there. As far as what we can do about it, it's a difficult thing because they're kind of off on their own. It's not something the legislature controls directly. We need a president of UMass that's going to go there with the intention of doing something about that. Now, they have a new one. I think it's Marty Meehan, former congressman from Lowell, I think. He was chosen, I believe, because he's very effective at fundraising. He's able to bring in a lot of money to colleges and universities. So perhaps he'll be able to do that, increase their endowment, and alleviate some of the expenses that way. Is he going to do that? Hard to say. He's only been there about a year, Doug. But Gary, you know, I wish you would tackle the cost point of it. Every time we have a funding problem, the immediate reaction of Beacon Hill is, well, we got to raise taxes, we got to raise funds, we got to raise spending. But they never look at the other side of it, at the expense side. And I think that's what they have to focus on. And they need to focus on what you just brought up. Why do we have so many people in administration? It shouldn't be that way. There's just way too much overhead. But it'll be interesting to see how it plays out. And that reminds me of something else, too. You know, we want to fix our roads and bridges. They're in terrible shape in this state. And, of course, the immediate reaction is, well, let's raise taxes. Let's raise the gas tax. Let's raise registry fees. Let's raise the income tax. They're talking about a surcharge on millionaires in the state. And they're going to dedicate the money to education and transportation. And that decision is always made without really considering the costs. And I come from the construction industry, so I started opening the books. And I found that we spend four times the national average for every mile of road. Not 4% or 40%, not 140%, no. Four times the national average for every mile of road. We spend more than twice as much as the other New England states. Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont spend a fraction of what we do, and their roads and bridges are in better shape. Okay? So, in my opinion, we shouldn't even dream of raising taxes until we figure out why we're spending so much just to make these repairs. And, you know, it's not an easy question. It's a lot of little things. It's not one thing. It's everything from police details to prevailing wage laws to the other requirements that go into bidding. It's very complicated, but in my opinion, we need to bring those costs under control before we even dream of asking for more money. But, you know, it's a difficult thing. Most people in Beacon Hill do not come from the business world. Many of you do. You worked in the private sector. You didn't work in government your whole life. So you have a different perspective on things, and that's the perspective I bring. I don't just throw money at an issue before I look at my expenses. I want to know if we're competitive in the first place. We shouldn't be spending four times the national average for every mile an hour. It just shouldn't be. But James, you had a question?
Well, I just wanted to expand on the fact that education for all of us is a lifetime duty. It behooves us to advocate for ourselves. So I think that if you're on Social Security or you're a senior citizen, if you're looking at credit, non-credit courses, those fees should be waived for senior citizens. Now, I don't know what that does to the school budgets, but most of the major universities in Massachusetts, the big ones, the state schools for the most part, do allow you to audit, cost-free. The ones that are fun to do, storytelling, Zen, computers. So maybe there's some legislation that probably should be.
I would think there probably already is a program to help fund something like that. But I can look into it.
A lot of it is you can get a voucher.
Yeah.
If you're a senior citizen and you've got to come up with the money and then get the voucher, or you get paid back later, like I said, knowing what the average Social Security payment is on a monthly basis, people don't have that kind of money to pay for those tuitions. I don't agree with you to death because we already chatted about it.
Okay. No, I got your information, James, and I'll definitely check it out.
Yeah, so I appreciate
Absolutely.
That.
Absolutely. But, you bring up a good point. We give a lot of free stuff now.
Tremendous. And all these people have worked, they pay taxes, they've supported their children, half of them have taken care of their grandchildren.
Sure.
Give me a break.
And people come into this country from all over the place.
We
give out free stuff. We give free K-12 education. Think about that. To anyone that walks into the country, if they move here, whether legally or illegally, and their son or daughter goes to school, they get a K-12 education. And like Gary mentioned, Georgetown does a great job below average, but we're still spending, it has to be $12,000-$13,000 per year per student, Gary? Something like that, right? It's right up there. Now imagine that, $13,000 per year for each student. And we got senior citizens that have lived here their whole lives, paid into the system their whole lives. We ought to be able to come up with $440 for a computer course. Isn't that what you said it costs?
Yeah, $448.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's for people that have lived here their whole lives that have paid into the system.
1939.
Yeah, that's a good point. Absolutely. And that brings up another issue that's probably going to come up soon too, is sanctuary cities and sanctuary state. There's a couple of state reps that have bills to make Massachusetts the first sanctuary state in America. And it's a very contentious thing. And I don't know where everyone stands on it, but I'm not anti-immigrant. My own parents are immigrants. My whole family came here from another country. But when they came here in the 50s and 60s, the story they'll tell me is that they had to go before a judge. They had to have a sponsor, go before a judge. And the sponsor was supposed to make sure that that immigrant would never end up on public assistance, that they would not be a burden on society, that they would follow our laws, learn the language, get a job, pay their taxes. And I kind of believe we need to go back to that kind of system. A sanctuary state, I don't think, is in our best interest. I think it makes the state more dangerous place. I think it makes us less fiscally responsible. It's an expensive thing to do what we just talked about, have people come in from all different countries speaking all different languages and throw them in our K-12 system and say, all right, now you have to teach them not only what we're teaching our own kids, but we have to teach them in their language. It's an expensive thing. And everything from schools to healthcare to law enforcement courts becomes more stressed as we bring in more people under a sanctuary state situation. So it's something we'll be tackling. And like I said, a lot of people are 100% in favor of it. The state reps that brought it forward are from cities that perhaps are already sanctuary cities. But it's something that we're gonna have to discuss. And like I said, I'm against it. I don't think we should be a sanctuary state. But it's another tough vote that we're going to probably have to take maybe this year. Go ahead, sir.
Why are we going over and over and over again? Who's causing the problems? It's from South America.
Oh.
They're the ones that's coming in here and causing all the damn problems.
Yeah, a lot of people from South America, yeah, could be that, but it almost doesn't matter with the company.
China or Norway or Sweden or anything talking about getting.
Oh, I know what you're saying, sir, but we can't differentiate where an immigrant comes from. I mean, just last month in the Globe, a gentleman from Ireland came here illegally, started a company, defrauded a lot of people. He's from Ireland. Spoke English, I'm sure, but he broke a lot of laws. He defrauded a lot of people, including a lot of seniors. He just took their money and ran. He was supposed to run a contracting company, I believe. He just took their money and ran and defrauded these seniors. Now, a guy like that shouldn't stay in this country. I just think he creates more problems than he solves. And, you know, some immigrants can be productive. If the country needs more, for instance, computer programmers, people to write code, or doctors, we need more general practitioner doctors. If someone from another country comes here and does one of those things, I think that's great, it helps the country. But when a guy comes in here and defrauds people and doesn't obey our laws, doesn't pay his taxes, it doesn't matter where he's from. He can be from Norway, Sweden, or South America, it doesn't matter. But in the eyes of the law, we kind of treat everyone the same.
How many South Americans come here living on our taxes?
Well, that's the scary part. We try to figure that out every year. Representative Jim Lyons from Andover does this every year. He tries to figure out what illegals are costing us. And the disgruntled part is we don't even know. The state doesn't even try to find out what illegals are costing the Commonwealth. Jim Lyons thinks it's about $2 billion. It's a billion with a B. So in a $4 billion budget, 5% goes to just that. I don't know how accurate that is, but
I can remember.
When you figure out the taxes that go to health care, education, and all the other things that are required, yeah, it's a big number.
The Eagle, years ago, did a story, several-week story, I think, on one woman that came in and what it was costing. This is probably 20 years ago because, you know, came here, had a bunch of children. They all ended up a lot of it was medical because they couldn't work because they were under a lot of stress. I can, Alex, somewhat disagree with you. I mean, I don't want to label everybody because there are a lot. I mean, I spent 35 years making my living in the office. And there were a lot, I worked with a lot of people there of ethnic backgrounds, and they were hardworking family people. So I like to be careful about labeling them all because there are a lot that work hard. But there's a lot
that come here illegally and stay. That's the ones I'm talking about.
It's just as Lenny said.
I came here, and I came here illegally.
Not disagreeing with you. I mean, there is.
I came here 70-some years ago.
They shouldn't
be illegally.
Yeah, shouldn't be a burden. I mean,
that's what it, Gary, that's it exactly. You shouldn't be a burden. I think anyone comes here should be a net positive for the country. Mm-hmm. If they're paying taxes, if they're paying Social Security, think about that. Our Social Security system, our Medicare system, is teetering on insolvency. There just aren't enough workers paying into those systems to keep them funded. And I'm sure everyone in this room wants to see Medicare and Social Security properly funded. So if a person comes here from a foreign country and pays their taxes and are funding those things, to me, that's a net positive. That's the kind of things we want to encourage, but we absolutely cannot do what you said, sir. We can't let people come here and end up on welfare and be a draw on the system. You're right, Gary.
It comes right down, basically, to what's really illegal. It's like buying votes. It really is. That's how a lot of people stay in office.
Anybody buys my votes, get their...
But that's how they do it. They buy it through the system.
Yeah.
You know,
unfortunately, it comes
down to supportive of the system.
I know.
I'm
not money coming in from Hollywood here to buy homes.
Yeah, but it's a contentious issue.
Corruption.
It is the corruption. I hate to say it, but it's true, Gary. It boils down to votes. I guess some legislators vote according to how their voters will respond. But you got to think long term. You know, we work for the Commonwealth and for the country, and we got to do what's best for the Commonwealth and the country in the long run. I don't want to break up families, but if someone's here illegally and they're a drain on the system and causing problems, we have to make a decision that's in the best interest of, of the long-term interests of the country and the Commonwealth. So, but Doug, you were going to say something?
Well, I was going to go down a different rabbit hole.
Okay.
Regarding vocational education, is there anything on the agenda coming up that to bolster or provide more funding for vocational education?
Yeah, we absolutely do. It's a huge success, especially in this district. We have Whittier Vocational Tech, which is almost a victim of its own success. People from outside the district are trying to get into Whittier, and it's actually squeezing out people that live in the district, and it's created a lot of ill will because, you know, we built it for our district here, and so someone from, I don't know, Andover wants to get in, and they're supposed to go to a different one. It's a real issue. But yes, we upgraded a lot of the facilities over there to keep up with changing times. So they have things like machine shops. They've had them in Whittier for a long time, but that industry is changing a lot. And the new machines are all computer generated, and so it takes a different kind of training to run a lathe, a bridge support, or whatever. And we did invest in a lot of that, thankfully, and they're doing a great job. Again, funding for that is getting squeezed like everything else, mostly because of healthcare. That affects not only the state's budget, but the superintendent that runs Whittier, you know, has one budget, just like every superintendent has one budget. They have to pay for everything from the snow plowing to the electricity to the salaries. And the thing that, even though we give them more money every year, their expenses go up higher than the increases we're giving them. And the expense that goes up is healthcare. They have to pay for the healthcare of all their employees, every student, every teacher, every janitor, every superintendent or administrator. And it's a big number. It's a huge number. And so it's kind of strangling the ability to properly fund the school. And it's a shame because they do a wonderful job. They're one of the best in the state, probably one of the best in the country. And they're filling a real need. Our economy is being strained because companies cannot hire enough people. Mirror company, I am. Our biggest challenge was hiring people. Everything from a truck driver to a backhoe operator to a foreman. Almost impossible to find, very, very difficult. And K-12 education doesn't really prepare you for those things. You have to learn certain skills to drive a truck, operate a backhoe, run a crew. And that's where Whittier Vocational Tech comes in. They'll teach people how to do everything from wire these lights, put down tile, how to frame and sheetrock a wall. And we need more people like that. We just don't have enough. And so there's so much work out there that a lot of it's not even getting done. It's just not getting done because companies cannot hire enough workers. And that used to be the case in healthcare and high tech. Now it's also the case in construction, the blue collar trades. And anyone who's tried to hire a plumber or an electrician for his house knows how true that is. Very difficult to find. And very expensive when you do find them. But we're doing it, Doug. We're trying to get more money there. Like I said, it's just a fiscal issue. Last fiscal year, we were, you know, a few hundred million dollars short of projections. We have to predict every year what tax revenues will be. You know, it's a $40 billion budget, so it can be higher or lower by a few hundred million quite easily. And now we got to fill that gap.
Well, speaking of that, has there been an increase in tax collections? Because I know that, what were they talking
there
about?
There are increases. The tax collections go up every year. I mean,
they were saying they were going to, the amount of taxes they're collecting is down by, like, what, half a million a month?
It's not that they're down, it's below projection. It's below what we predicted. We predict that tax collections go up every year, but we have to predict how much come in sales tax, how much come in income tax, and how much come in capital gains tax. Those are the big three. And income and sales taxes are pretty evenly distributed. We can predict them pretty accurately. Capital gains is a different story. It's almost impossible to predict what the capital gains taxes are going to be. And that, I think, is what fell way short last year, was our capital gains taxes. And there's a lot of theories why. A lot of big investors perhaps are waiting for Washington to come up with a new tax code. And so maybe they're waiting for the capital gains tax to go down next year, so they're holding off on selling things. Could be any number of things, Doug. But revenues go up every year. I want to say our budget goes up by about $1 billion a year. It's just that our spending increases even faster than that. And so the other issue that will come up this year, in fact, it's going to be on the ballot, is a millionaire's tax. And a lot of people want to apply an additional 4% on the income tax to everyone who makes $1 million or more. And they're pledging that to go to education and transportation. I'd love to see more go to education and transportation. But keep in mind, our Constitution prohibits that. The Constitution does not allow a ballot question to direct money at education or transportation. So we can promise to spend it there. And I'm sure we will the first year, maybe the second year. But what about 2 years later when a new legislature gets voted in? Are they going to be bound by that promise to use that millionaire's tax on just education and transportation? They're not bound by it. They can spend it on whatever they want. So it's a tricky thing. And like I said earlier, I don't think we should look at the tax increases before we look at our expenses. We're spending way too much. We're way above the national average on a lot of things. I talked about transportation, but also, you know, not just roads and bridges, but the MBTA. The MBTA spends way more than the national average for every ride it gives on a bus or a train or a subway. It just shouldn't be that high. And so, you know, we're looking at things like privatizing bus maintenance because our bus maintenance facilities at the MBTA are very, you know, they're expensive. It's probably a lot of waste there. Maybe it's what Gary brought up earlier. A lot of administrative staff get dumped there. So we're looking at privatizing bus maintenance to bring down those costs. And it's a contentious issue. You know, the unions in Boston are very powerful, and they don't want to see that privatized. So, you know, we'll have a fight on our hands, but we're trying to save money. And I have to say, this governor has done a good job at the MBTA. We suspended the Pacheco Law, which made it easier to privatize certain things, and we're saving tens of millions of dollars a year as a result. But it's a tough fight. It's very complicated, very tedious, and you know, it's going to be done one step at a time. One good thing we did is we finally figured out a way to start collecting fares. That sounds crazy, but for a long time, people were able to jump on MBTA trains without paying a fare. And it wasn't a small amount of money. It was tens of millions of dollars every single year. And you know, it's kind of crazy. Every major city in the world has mass transit. They have buses and trains and subways. And they find a way to collect fares. It's not like we're reinventing the wheel here. And you know, we privatize that end of it. We privatize the money counter room. That saved a lot of money. So it's something that's going to be done one step at a time. And I'll end by saying the story. The governor would go, when he first got elected, immediately jumped on the MBTA because he knew there was a lot of waste there. He knew we were spending way too much money. And one thing they looked at was something as simple as office supplies. And I think they get their office supplies from W.B. Mason. Millions and millions of dollars a year. And so someone in the Baker administration said, well, we spend so much money there, why don't we ask for a discount? And the response from the MBTA people was, what's a discount? What's a discount? And he said, well, you're spending millions of dollars. I'm sure the company would give you a break on prices if you just asked for it. So they called W.B. Mason, said, hey, this is the MBTA. We spend millions of dollars every year. Can we get a discount? They said, absolutely. We'd love to give you a discount. We'll just ask you to do us one favor. One favor. And we said, well, what's that? He said, can you start ordering your supplies the same way the rest of the world does? We said, well, what do you mean? He goes, someone at the MBTA insists that all orders have to be faxed to W.B. Mason. So W.B. Mason has to pay a person to stand by the fax machine and take in these orders and then enter it electronically. The rest of the world just goes online and does it directly. And that's how we were stuck in the last century at the MBTA ordering office supplies the way they did 27 years, 30 years ago. And it's little things like that that just government doesn't figure out. You know, they just have these policies that says it has to go through certain channels, all of us have to be okayed, and then it has to be faxed. And W.B. Mason has to have a person standing by the fax machine to take in the orders. And, you know, I shook my head. I went around the state with the governor, and he told the story a number of times. People just shook their heads and saying, you know, it's about time. This is what we have to do. So, you know, it's little things like that. I wish I could tell you that, you know, if we could just pass this one bill, wave a magic wand, we can fix all our fiscal woes. It's not. It's a lot of little things, not one or two big things. But we're getting there. And, you know, it's part of what we do. So, but thank you. Yeah, sure.
One thing.
Yeah.
In the legislature, are there any, it's kind of like an oxymoron, I don't know, but are there any conservative Democrats?
Oh, there are. Oh, absolutely.
Go along with Republican initiatives?
Absolutely. Listen. There's 160 state reps, only 35 Republicans. We couldn't get anything passed were it not for at least a handful of moderate and conservative Democrats. You know, a lot of the older guys are old-style Democrats in the mold of a JFK or a Harry Truman. You know, they go back a ways. When that was a party of blue-collar workers, middle-class families. And they still have those conservative values today. Absolutely. We work with them all the time. And as a party, that's probably the most one-party state in America. Republicans can't do a thing here without working with Democrats. And there's nothing wrong with that. We should be working with both parties. And we do it on a daily basis. And thankfully, this speaker is actually kind of a moderate himself. He's an older guy, Speaker DeLeo, I think is 65 or 70 years old. And he puts pretty moderate people in as chairman for committees, which is vitally important, because those chairmen ultimately decide what bills get heard, what come out of committee, what comes out of committee voted favorably. They have a lot of power. And I'm on the committee for telecommunications, utilities, and energy. And Tom Golden from Lowell is a Democrat, a very moderate guy, very easy to work with. I can sit down and talk like this any day of the week. And it's a vitally important committee because it includes things like solar power and how we're going to handle our utility companies in this state. And how we're going to handle things like internet connections and the price of gas and the price of electricity. And he's a very down-to-earth guy who knows what he's doing. And so to answer your question, Doug, yeah, we have a lot of pretty moderate Democrats. Diana DiSaglio from Methuen is another one. She votes against her party a lot. I think she voted against the pay raise. She votes against a lot of things that would cause this Commonwealth to be spending out of control. And she's a pretty down-to-earth Democrat. She's a young lady, too, which is admirable. And it's very hard for someone on that party to vote against the speaker, because when you do, bad things happen to you. Now, all of a sudden, you don't get that committee chair that pays an extra $30,000 a year.
Well, Harriet Stanley found that out.
She found that out. She had my seat before I did. Yeah. She was on healthcare finance. Yeah. And I don't know what she did exactly, but the speaker at the time was Thomas Fetterman, and all of a sudden, she lost her chairmanship, along with a giant pay raise, which, like you said earlier, Gary, you're right, it affects their pension down the road, because your pension is based on your highest 3 years of pay. And so, if you don't get that chairmanship stipend, your pension is affected for the rest of your life. So the speaker wields a lot of power. And, it's unfortunate, in my opinion, because he kind of dictates a lot of what happens as a result of that, because people have to vote his way if they're going to get that big office with the big chairmanship stipends. Yeah. But it's how the state runs, so it's what we're faced with on a daily basis.
Speaking about democracy, what old Greeks, what did they call democracy? What is it called?
They invented democracy.
Democracy is ruled by the penniless masses. Mm-hmm. You show me anybody in the world today.
Yeah.
Ruled by the penniless masses.
We are. Unfortunately, on Beacon Hill, it's not really a democracy. It's a republic, and we have elected officials that do the bidding. In town meeting, it's different. In town meeting, you have a simple count of the votes. That's pure democracy. The people go there and vote yay or nay on something. But yeah, unfortunately, sir, Beacon Hill doesn't work that way. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You have my contact information, please. If you have any questions, concerns, give me a call. Thanks.